Hachette Digital presents A Deadly Brew by Susanna Gregory, read by David Thorpe. Prologue. October 1352. The afternoon had been growing gradually darker as storm clouds massed overhead. The scholar glanced up at them and realised he would not be able to reach the abbey at Ely, still some 9 miles distant, without getting drenched. In his saddlebags, he carried several finely illustrated manuscripts that had been given to him by the grateful parents of successful students. If they became wet, the ink would run and they would be ruined. He cursed softly to himself. The summer and autumn had been unusually dry, so why did the heavens have to choose now, while he was forced to travel, to soak the parched earth with rain? With an irritated sigh, he urged his horse into a trot along the raised causeway that snaked through the desolate marshes. Since the storm would break long before he could hope to claim refuge with the monks at Ely, he resigned himself to the fact that he would have to take shelter at the Franciscan convent of Denny Abbey, the ramshackle rooftops of which he could already see poking above the scrubby fenland vegetation. From a dense tangle of bushes at the side of the road, 3 men watched the scholar's progress impatiently and heaved a sigh of relief when the sound of his horse's hooves finally faded into the distance. They had no wish to be caught unsheltered in the storm that was brewing either. They clambered down the slippery bank of the causeway to the barge that was moored at the side of the canal and seized the ropes by which it was drawn along. It was more usual for horses to be used for towing barges, but there was always a risk that the beasts might give away the presence of the boat to travellers on the road, and that would be unfortunate for everyone concerned. The 3 men hauled on the ropes, and the barge was on the move, slipping soundlessly along the black, glassy waters of the channel that eventually meandered behind Denny Abbey's walled gardens. They heard voices as the scholar was admitted into the nun's guest house, and then all was silent again, except for the gurgle of water under the keel and the occasional sound of dead, dry reeds snapping under their feet as they walked. When the bargemen reached their destination, they coiled the tow ropes and began to unload their cargo, a number of roughly sewn sacks, the contents of which clanked together mysteriously as they were moved. One of the men, younger than the others and curious, started to untie the cord that fastened the top of one particularly heavy sack. His friends, seeing what he was about to do, leapt forward to stop him.
"Fool! We were told to deliver the sacks without asking questions. They will kill us if they think we've been prying into their business."
The young man scowled angrily.
"If the cargo is so valuable, why did you charge him so little to bring it here? And why did you agree to deliver it at all if you're so frightened of him?"
"Because it was impossible to refuse once asked,"
said the other, lowering his voice and glancing around him uneasily.
"But when we have finished here, we will lie low for a while to make sure we are not hired for this again."
The younger man treated his friends to a look of scorn for their timidity and returned to the heavy labour of removing the sacks from the barge to their hiding place. After a moment, the other two followed suit, straining and sweating under the weight of the irregularly shaped bundles. The voices, however, had carried across the otherwise silent fens. Had they looked behind them, they would have seen the veiled head of a nun observing them from one of the upper windows of the convent. She stood, unmoving, watching them struggle with their bundles until, with evident relief and a few final furtive glances around them, they finished and slipped away as silently as they had arrived. Within moments, the first drops of rain began to fall, lightly at first, but then harder, until the lonely marshes were enveloped in a misty white pall as far as the eye could see. The nun tapped a forefinger on the windowsill thoughtfully before going to pay her respects to the scholar waiting in the guest house. December 1352. The thief pressed back into the shadows as the soldiers of the night watch passed so close he could have touched them. He grinned to himself, guessing that they were more interested in returning to the fire in the guardroom than in checking the dark streets and alleyways for furtive figures who were breaking the curfew. Once the guard's footsteps had echoed into silence, the thief continued his meticulous examination of the windows and doors of houses, hunting for a faulty lock that would let him inside. Just as he was beginning to despair, he discovered that a hatch leading to a cellar had been carelessly left open. The thief looked both ways before easing himself through the hatch and pulling it closed behind him. The cellar was pitch black, but this did not deter the thief. He was used to working under difficult conditions. He groped his way around damp walls and a low ceiling with flaking plaster, but, to his disappointment, found the cellar contained nothing he could steal to sell in the taverns. There were a few empty wooden boxes, all of them soft and rotten with mould, but the room smelt wet and stale and had evidently been disused and forgotten for decades. He flapped dispiritedly at a cobweb that brushed across his face and decided to try for richer pickings elsewhere. As he began to make his way towards the door, his foot bumped against something hard. He crouched down, hands extended to assess whether it was something worth taking. A crate of wine. His fingers traced the smooth glass outline of bottles that the moist air of the cellar had rendered damp and cold. They had probably been there for years, and their contents would doubtless be sour by now. But, reasoned the thief, whoever bought them from him in the Brazen George would not know that until they had paid, and by then he would be long gone. Deftly, he began packing the bottles into the sack he carried over his shoulder, wrapping each one in the rotting straw that littered the floor so they would not clank together and betray his whereabouts to the night watch. 6 bottles were wrapped and stowed away when the thief became aware that the hatch to the cellar was opening and someone else was entering. Frightened, he pulled the drawstring of his bag tight and hefted it over his shoulder, abandoning the remaining 6 bottles. He stood up carefully and moved back among the crates, desperately hoping that the second intruder had not brought a lamp with him. The thief was small, quick, and expert at gaining access to other people's property, but he abhorred fighting and violence and avoided any kind of confrontation with victims if he could. Thus, when the second man moved silently into the centre of the room, the thief nimbly sidestepped him in the inky darkness and was out into the night as fast as his legs could carry him. He darted towards the river and disappeared into the fringe of reeds that choked the banks, breathing heavily. Moments passed, and there was no sound of pursuit. He was safe. He heaved a shuddering sigh of relief and lowered the sack of bottles to the ground next to him while he considered his next move. He could sell the wine for enough to keep him in bread for a week if he told people it was finest claret and charged a penny a bottle. He raised an eyebrow and allowed himself a grin of satisfaction. Perhaps it had not been such a bad night after all. Back in the cellar, the other man had lit a candle and was staring down at the half-empty wine box with a mixture of horror and fury. A rat slithered across the floor behind him, and he spun round, a knife appearing in his hand as though by magic. He relaxed when he saw the rodent's tail disappear behind the pile of crates, but did not sheathe his dagger. He rubbed his chin with a hand that shook and wondered who had stolen the wine and why. A glimmer of a smile flickered across the man's harsh features. Whoever it was would be in for an unpleasant shock when the bottles were opened. The certain knowledge that the crime would not go unavenged helped to counterbalance the intense and impotent anger he felt towards the thief. Chapter 1. Cambridge, late January 1353. Rain slanted across Michael House's yard in a steady hiss, drumming on the wooden roof of the stable and staining the college's honey-coloured stone walls a deep amber. The cat, its fur soaked into black spikes, sat morosely under the meagre shelter of a leafless tree and watched a scholar, clad in the ceremonial red robes of a university doctor, splash his way across the muddy yard. The scholar paused for a moment to glance up at the dull grey sky before disappearing through one of the doorways that led to the rooms where the students and their masters lived. "We will be late," he warned, looking round the door of Brother Michael's chamber and seeing that the monk was not yet ready to leave. Michael made no reply and stood in front of a strategically placed silver plate, plastering his thin, light brown hair into place with dabs of water. This performed to his satisfaction, he turned his attention to his newly purchased Benedictine habit, brushing away imaginary dust with the head of a teasel. Matthew Bartholomew sighed impatiently, striding across the room to lean out of the window. "The bell has already stopped ringing." Michael waved a dismissive hand and continued with his primping.
"There is no point in attending these festivities if we do not look our best, Matt," he said, taking up an ornate cross of gold and hanging it round his neck, careful not to disturb his immaculate hair.
"It is not you being installed as Master of the Hall of Valence Marie, brother," Bartholomew pointed out. He gazed across Michael House's yard at the undergraduates hurrying from their lectures to the midday meal. "In fact, I do not understand why we should be there at all. I still have not finished Galen's Prognostica with my third-year students. There is an outbreak of sickness among the river people, and I want to work on my treatise on fevers. This installation is a distraction I could do without." Michael gave an exasperated shake of his head.
"You think of nothing but your work these days," he chided. "This grand installation will be good for you. You can see all the great and powerful of the university gathered together under one roof and watch the games being played."
"Over the past 5 years, I've seen enough of the university's games to last me a lifetime," said Bartholomew vehemently. "I want only to teach my students and attend my patients." Michael's green eyes gleamed. He thrived on the intrigues and plots that were as much a part of university life as teaching, and loved nothing more than to attend an event like the installation of the new Master of the Hall of Valence Marie, where he could watch alliances being formed and plans being hatched to avenge ancient grievances. As well as being a fellow of Michael House, Michael was senior proctor, a position that meant he was well placed to observe and meddle in the murky affairs of the university and its scheming scholars.
"Besides," the monk said briskly, ignoring Bartholomew's grumbling and turning his head this way and that as he studied his reflection in the plate, "all fellows of Michael House were personally invited by the master-elect. It would be ungracious to decline, especially if the reason is that you prefer teaching and seeing patients."
He took a thick winter cloak from a hook on the wall and draped it over his shoulders, fiddling with it until he was sure the expensive cloth fell in even folds before carefully lifting the hood over his head. Then he stepped over to the plate once more and admired the finished product, adjusting a strand of hair here and a fold of his habit there. He glimpsed his friend's morose expression as he continued to stare out of the window and tapped him lightly on the shoulder.
"Forget your students, Matt. Forget your patients too. Enjoy yourself for once."
With a group of men whose idea of fun is an all-night debate on the efficacy of Occam's razor? Asked Bartholomew gloomily. Or worse still, with those of our colleagues who will drink the new master's free wine until they are sick, violent, or miserable.
"You are in a miserable mood today," said Michael, amused. "But you will make us late by keeping me here chattering. Come on, hurry up. We do not want to arrive last."
Glumly, Bartholomew followed Michael down the wooden stairs and out into the yard, a morass of churned mud from the rain that had fallen almost incessantly since Christmas. The cat, seeing the door had been left open, tried in vain to reach it without getting its feet wet. Despite his ill humour, the physician could not help smiling when he noted a similarity between the cat's dainty, careful footsteps and those of Michael, who held his habit clear of the ground with thumbs and forefingers. The monk cursed and swore at the brown slime that oozed over his carefully polished sandals in language that belied his contemplative vocation.
"I have never seen such rain," he muttered. "We are a cursed race. First came the pestilence that claimed so many lives. Then there was the drought of last summer when we baked under a sun that turned the whole country brown. And now we have endless rain. The crops will rot in the fields and there will be an even greater shortage of bread than there is now. You mark my words."
"Rain in winter should not be a problem," said Bartholomew, splashing along beside Michael, oblivious to the mud.
He had dressed in his best scarlet robe when he had finished teaching, around 10 o'clock that Saturday morning, but had been called out to tend a patient with a winter fever. His feet were already wet inside his boots, and avoiding puddles would make little difference to him now. "It is summer rain that rots the crops in the fields."
Michael shot him a disbelieving glance and continued with his litany of complaints.
"This rain is worse than snow. The roof leaks in my room, and I can barely sleep for the noise of drips falling into the bucket."
Bartholomew recalled pulling the bed covers over his ears the night before in a vain effort to muffle the sound of Michael's snores thundering from the room above his, and treated the monk's words with scepticism.
"And the dampness is unbearable. All my bones ache with it,"
Michael added, looking resentfully up to a lead-grey sky that made the noon light seem like late afternoon. Bartholomew turned to him in concern.
"Do they?
Do you need a physic? I have a poultice that, if applied daily, can ease soreness in the joints."
Michael sighed and gave a wry grin.
"I am not so bad that I need a physic. It is nothing a dry blanket and a doze by a fire would not cure. But this foul weather must be hard on your older patients."
Bartholomew nodded. "A number of them are complaining about painful joints. But it is this winter fever that worries me. I've never seen anything quite like it."
"It is not like the death, then?"
asked Michael, picking his way cautiously around a gigantic puddle that shivered and rippled as the rain pattered into it. Bartholomew shuddered.
"No, thank God."
Even after 5 years, Bartholomew had not forgotten his helplessness in the face of the plague that had defied all treatment and seemed to strike at random, carrying off at least a third of the population of Cambridge and completely annihilating the people who lived in the impoverished little settlement near the castle, where cramped and filthy conditions seemed to hasten the disease's relentless progress. They reached Michael House's great gates and unlatched the wicket door. Michael stepped into the lane and rinsed the mud off his feet in a puddle of cleanish water, wincing at its coldness. They walked up the lane and then along the high street towards the Hall of Valence Marie. For a while, they were forced to abandon conversation and concentrate on avoiding the deep potholes that lurked unseen under the flooded surface of the road. They passed St. Michael's Church, short, squat, and an even darker grey than usual with the rain blackening its walls, and then St. Mary's, with its creamy yellow stone and delicate traceried windows. The houses between them looked shabby in the wet, and the resin from their timbers leached out to ooze in dirty brown trails down their whitewashed walls. The Hall of Valence Marie, where Bartholomew and Michael were to attend the ceremonies for the installation of its new master, stood just outside the town boundary, near the Trumpington Gate.
They were about to pass through it when a young man tore up to them, gasping for breath, his eyes wild and his clothes dishevelled.
Brother Armel is dying. It was not what we intended. You must believe me.
He took a handful of Michael's best cloak and tried to haul him back towards the town. Michael disengaged himself firmly, resentful at being manhandled after he had taken so much trouble with his appearance.
"What are you shouting about?"
he demanded crossly, trying to brush the creases out of his sleeve.
"Who is Brother Armel, and what must I believe?"
The boy gulped for breath, clenching and unclenching his hands, and clearly forcing himself to resist the urge to grab at Michael again in his agitation. "It will be quicker if you speak rationally," said Bartholomew gently, taking pity on the frantic student. "Tell us what has happened. Is someone ill? Do you need a physician?" The young man nodded and then shook his head. He took a deep breath, screwed his eyes tightly shut, and fought to gain control of himself.
I and the other students were drinking in the Brazen George,"
he began, referring to a tavern near St. Mary's Church. Michael gave him an admonishing stare. Students were not allowed in the town's taverns, chiefly because the university did not want bands of drunken undergraduates meeting gangs of equally intoxicated townspeople. The relationship between university and town was uneasy at best, violent at worst, and it took very little to spark off fights that resulted in bloodshed on both sides. The young man continued.
"A man sold us wine. We took it home and Armel drank from the bottle. Then he fell into a swoon. He was poisoned. You must come."
The lad's story was still far from clear, but Bartholomew guessed they would prize no more sense from him until one of them went to see Brother Armel. It occurred to him that not even the sensibilities of the master-elect of the Hall of Valence Marie could be offended if his excuse for being absent was that he was dealing with a medical emergency. He seized the opportunity with sudden enthusiasm. "You go to the ceremony," he said to Michael. "I will see Brother Armel."
"But he needs you both,"
pleaded the student, his hands furiously twisting the buckle on his belt to avoid laying hands on the august personage of the university's senior proctor a second time.
"He needs last rites and a physician."
His self-control finally broke, and he grasped Bartholomew's cloak to haul him back up the high street, evidently assuming Michael would follow.
"Then you need a priest, not a monk," called Michael, standing firm. "One of the Gilbertines will oblige, or the Carmelites just across the road. I have pressing business to attend." "You can give last rites," said the student, accusingly, turning back to him without relinquishing his hold on Bartholomew. "You did so during the death. Father Ivo told us how you gave last rites to his predecessor. And you have heard my confessions before now."
The student was right. While friars lived and worked among the people, monks led contemplative lives in the cloister and were not authorised to hear confessions or give last rites. But Michael had been granted special dispensation by his bishop so that he might attend the needs of the small number of Benedictines enrolled at the university. During the plague, he had been tireless in his spiritual duties and had trudged around the town with Bartholomew, tending the hopeless cases. These days, however, he seldom drew on his authority, preferring to advance the Benedictines' earthly interests rather than their spiritual ones.
"Please,"
cried the student, desperation making his voice crack.
"We need the senior proctor and a physician. Armel has been murdered."
How poor Armel had gone so suddenly from a swoon to being a murder victim was unclear, but Bartholomew allowed himself to be led back along the high street by the frightened student. Michael followed reluctantly, muttering bitterly about missing the installation ceremony to which he had been so looking forward. Bartholomew did not for an instant imagine they would find Brother Armel murdered, nor even poisoned.
The student, who tugged and heaved at his cloak to make him hurry, was very young, no more than 15 years old at the most, and Bartholomew was sure he would not be able to tell a drunken stupor from an unconsciousness brought on by poison. He wondered how much of the installation he might legitimately escape, although a backward glance at Michael's black scowl suggested the answer would be very little if the monk had any say in the matter.
"Which hostel do you live in?" Bartholomew asked, more to soothe the student's increasing agitation than to solicit information.
"Bernard's," said the student, hauling harder still as they drew closer to the dirty brown façade of St. Bernard's Hostel.
"My name is Xavier."
"Bernard's is a Franciscan institution," said Bartholomew, puzzled. "So why are you not wearing your friar's habit?" Xavier gave him a look of disbelief. "Could not go to the Brazen George wearing our habits. The landlord would know we were students and would refuse to serve us." Before Bartholomew could comment further, he was propelled into the building. A large room that opened directly off the street was occupied by six students, all arguing among themselves in apprehensive whispers. None of them wore either scholars' tabards or the robes of Franciscan novices, and Bartholomew imagined the entire hostel must have been involved in the illicit trip to the tavern. As they entered, the students parted to reveal someone lying on the floor with his eyes closed. Bartholomew knelt to examine him, while Michael snapped questions at the others.
"Where is Father Evo? He is principal here, is he not?"
Miserably, the students nodded, some hanging their heads, and none able to meet the stern visage Michael reserved for dealing with recalcitrant undergraduates.
"He is at the installation, but Brother Henry has gone to fetch him home," said Xavier. "I came to find you. I was lucky to catch you before you reached Valence Marie."
Michael's grimace suggested he did not consider the encounter to be a fortuitous one.
"I suppose you took advantage of Father Evo's absence to go visiting taverns,"
he surmised, eyeing the students' odd assortment of secular clothes with proctorly disapproval. They nodded again, exchanging guilty glances and shuffling their feet uncomfortably.
"Well, Brother Xavier," said Michael, eyeing the sheepish undergraduates with weary reproach, "now you have me here, tell me what happened properly."
Xavier took a deep breath, less anxious now that Michael had assumed control of the situation.
"We have all worked really hard this term, and yesterday the last of us passed our disputations. It seemed as though we were being given a perfect opportunity to celebrate, with Father Evo at the installation along with all the other masters, principals and fellows, and proctors," he added, giving Michael a sidelong glance.
"We meant no harm. Just a tankard or two of ale and we would have been home. None of us intended to become drunk."
This statement was confirmed vehemently by a chorus of agreement from the others.
"Then a man offered to sell us some wine. He was asking a very reasonable price for claret from France, and we thought we could bring it here and continue our celebrations more discreetly. We bought three bottles and came home."
"What did this man look like?"
asked Michael, reflecting with a distinct lack of enthusiasm on all the petty thieves he knew who might approach a gaggle of gullible undergraduates and sell them inferior wine under the pretense that it was fine quality stuff from abroad. He supposed the culprit would be well away by now, doubtless enjoying the congratulations of his cronies for having so easily cheated members of the university the townspeople so despised. Xavier looked to his friends for help.
"Not tall. He had a brown beard.
He wore a blue tunic,"
put in a student with freckles and red hair, who looked about 14.
"And his hose were undyed homespun," put in another, "like these."
He plucked at the rough material of his leggings and looked expectantly at Michael, as if the monk should immediately know the identity of the wine cellar from this meagre scrap of information.
"He had brown eyes," added the red-haired student uncertainly.
"No, he had blue eyes," said Xavier, frowning as he tried to remember. "Well, sort of blue-grey. And there was something wrong with the skin on his hands."
"And what happened after you brought your ill-gotten gains back here?"
the monk asked, looking from one to the other with eyebrows raised in disapprobation.
"Brother Armel was carrying one of the bottles. When we arrived..."
Xavier faltered, gazing down at his feet, and the red-haired student took up the story.
"Brother Armel opened his bottle, took a great swig and..."
"And what?" prompted Michael. As one, the novice Franciscans looked to where Armel lay on the floor. Xavier gave a sudden sob, loud in the otherwise silent room.
"He staggered for a moment," continued the red-haired student unsteadily. "Then he grabbed at his throat and fell to the floor. We thought he was playing the fool, so we ignored him at first. Then we tried to rouse him, but it did no good."
He swallowed hard.
"Brother Henry said he would fetch Father Evo, but Xavier said we needed the proctors because Armel had been..."
"Poisoned," finished Xavier in a whisper as the red-haired student failed to utter the dreaded word. One or two of the novices crossed themselves, and all eyes were once again fixed on the prone figure on the floor. Xavier choked back another sob and continued with his tale.
"I ran to fetch Father Phileas, the master of medicine at Gonville Hall, but he is sick himself and could not come. Then I went to look for you."
Michael pursed his lips at the sorry tale and looked down to where Bartholomew still knelt next to Armel.
"Well, is Armel's sudden fainting a case of too much ale and too few wits, like the rest of these silly boys?"
Bartholomew shook his head and met his friend's gaze somberly. "Not at all, brother. Xavier's suspicions seem to have been correct. Armel has been poisoned." Michael's jaw dropped.
"You mean he is dead?"
he asked in a whisper. The students hurriedly crossed themselves again, and one or two dropped to their knees to begin intoning prayers for the dying in uncertain voices. Bartholomew nodded helplessly and stood. There was nothing more he could do for Armel. The young man needed a priest to give him last rites to ensure the safety of his soul for whatever journey it was about to take. Michael pulled himself together, dispatched Xavier to fetch the chrism he was sure Father Evo would have, and began to recite the office for the dead. Bartholomew withdrew to the far side of the room and watched. When Xavier returned with the little bottle of holy oil, Michael used it to trace a cross on Armel's forehead, mouth, hands, and feet. Bartholomew had seen Michael perform last rites many times when the plague had ravaged the town, and the monk's ministrations had been of far more comfort to the victims than Bartholomew's desperate, hopeless treatments. Watching Michael kneeling next to a dead youngster brought back memories that made Bartholomew's blood run cold. He looked away. As Michael finished and clambered inelegantly to his feet, Father Evo, dragged from the celebrations at Valence Marie, entered the room at a run. He gazed at Armel in horror, and his eyes widened in shock as he heard Michael's brief summary of what had happened.
He swung round to Bartholomew. "You are a physician. Can you do nothing to help him? Perhaps we can make him drink water to wash the poisons out. Perhaps if we stood him up and made him walk..."
Bartholomew spread his hands helplessly. "He was beyond all earthly help when I arrived, Father. The poison had settled too far into his body for me to do anything to save him. I'm sorry."
Where is this wine he drank?
Asked Michael of the watching novices. Xavier presented a slender smoked glass bottle, which the monk took from him warily. He inspected it minutely, lifting it to the light to see if he could detect any residues, and then sniffed cautiously at it. Bartholomew moved towards him quickly, afraid that he might inhale noxious fumes. But Michael shook his head to indicate that he could detect nothing. Meanwhile, Ivo had gathered his novices around him and had them kneeling in a circle around the dead Armel.
There is nothing more we can do here,
Michael whispered to Bartholomew, watching them pray.
I will return tomorrow when they are less shocked and try to gain a better description of this wine cellar. Meanwhile, I am sure my beadles will be delighted with the task of visiting the taverns to see if they can find a man hawking illicit claret.
Bartholomew took the bottle from him and wrapped it in his hat. From what the students say, Armel took only a single mouthful of this, and yet it affected him immediately. The poison must be very strong. He beckoned Xavier away from his prayers, collected the two unopened bottles, and instructed the tearful student to tell everyone to wash their hands, lest some dangerous residue remain. This done, Bartholomew and Michael took their leave. Michael stepped outside with evident relief and began to head back along the high street towards the Hall of Valence Marie. The rain still fell, and the day seemed more dismal than ever.
What a ghastly business, he said with a shudder. Poor Father Ivo. He runs a respectable hostel, unlike some of the establishments I could mention around here, and he is still not immune to foul play.
Foul play, echoed Bartholomew thoughtfully. I hope this does not herald the beginning of another sour period between university and town. There are still ill feelings over those riots of last summer, and I would not like to see all that started again.
Lord Matt, sighed Michael, his baggy green eyes anxious. This could have a devastating impact on town and gown relations. The university will be suspicious of trading with the merchants, and the townspeople will be anticipating a revenge attack at every turn.
He stopped walking and stood still, his mind working quickly.
You are right, in that the atmosphere is still uneasy between the students and the townspeople. It would take very little before we are back to the riots and lootings of August.
But we might be jumping to the wrong conclusion, said Bartholomew, taking Michael's arm to make him continue walking. The rain was blowing straight into the physician's face, and he felt chilled to the bone.
There is always the possibility that this wine seller did not know his wares were poisoned, or even that he was unaware Xavier and his friends were students. They were not wearing their habits after all. Come on, Matt, said Michael tiredly. Of course he knew. You recognise Xavier immediately as a student, even in secular clothes, and so would any intelligent person. And what kind of man does not know that the wine he sold to a handful of credulous lads, in a tavern, mind you, under the very nose of the man whose trade he is stealing, is poisoned?
One who perhaps bought the wine from someone else? Mused Bartholomew. Michael considered for a moment and then dismissed the idea.
No, that is too contrived. Why would someone provide an innocent man with poisoned wine to sell? No, Matt, you were right with your first guess that someone is aiming to foul the relationship between university and town. But what about this poison in the wine? Can you tell me anything about it, other than that it was horribly powerful?
Bartholomew shook his head. All I can say is that it did not kill Armel instantly, but rendered him unconscious and blistered his lips. They walked towards the Hall of Valence Marie, each lost in his own thoughts.
Michael fretted over the possibility that his beloved university was once more to be the victim of the townspeople's ire, while Bartholomew tried to fight away the feelings of helpless inadequacy he always experienced when he lost a patient. Despite the rain, the high street thronged with people. Liveried apprentices scampered this way and that as they ran their master's errands, while carts with heavy wooden wheels ferried goods to and from the market square and the river barges moored at the wharves. Here and there, strangers to the town gawked at the sumptuous buildings that lined the town's main thoroughfare, such as the wealthy new College of Corpus Christi and the Blessed Virgin, founded just the previous year, with its mullioned windows and carved pediments, the sumptuous guild houses with their coats of arms emblazoned over their doors, and the homes of the merchants with their stained glass windows and decorative plaster. Few of them paid much attention to the untidy houses of Cambridge's less wealthy inhabitants that were crammed in the spaces between them, noticeable only because their badly built walls and sagging roofs seemed to defy gravity. Street vendors proclaimed the virtues of their wares in ringing voices, vying with each other and with the constant clatter of horses' hooves and the thunder of wagons rumbling past. A small white dog, showing patches of black and pink skin through its filthy coat, yapped and worried at a small herd of sheep that was being driven to the slaughterhouse, so that frightened bleats added another tenor to the general cacophony. They reached the Trumpington Gate and elbowed their way through the crowd, squeezing past an indignant pardoner who was being denied access to the town for some spurious reason known only to the sergeant in charge of the guards. The sergeant waved cheerfully at Bartholomew, who had once set his broken leg, and then rearranged his face into a black scowl as he turned his attention back to the trader who was being refused admittance. Michael nodded approvingly as the sergeant sent the man packing. He did not like pardoners. Once outside the gate, it grew quieter. The buildings gradually petered out to give way to narrow strips of fields tilled by the villagers who lived on the manor of Sir Roger de Panton. Opposite, water meadows rolled down to the River Cam, a peaceful swathe of grass lined with trees where people grazed their cattle, or did before it had become swamped and boggy from the rain. Bartholomew stopped walking and looked up at the Hall of Valence Marie, looming in front of him. "The last thing I feel like doing now is celebrating an installation." "Me too," said Michael, pulling the hood of his black cloak further over his head against the chill. "I was looking forward to this. Giving last rites to a child has blunted my desire to enjoy myself." They stood in silence for a moment as they looked up at the powerful walls of the young college. It was a splendid building, comprising four ranges around a central courtyard, protected by powerful walls and a squat gatehouse tower. Founded only 6 years before, it enjoyed the patronage of the wealthy Countess of Pembroke, who ensured her college had the best architects and building materials money could buy. "So, why did you decide not to accept the position of Master of Valence Marie when it was offered to you last year?" asked Bartholomew, changing the subject from the poisoned wine, but still making no move to enter. "You would have made them a fine master." Michael looked shy.
"I felt I was too young for such a position," he replied, bending down to brush at the mud on his habit.
"Nonsense, brother," said Bartholomew mildly. "What was your real reason?" Michael gave a short bark of laughter and slapped his friend on the back.
"You know me too well, perhaps far too well for a man destined for great things."
"I assume you mean you, not me," asked Bartholomew, smiling an absent greeting to one of his patients, who waved before disappearing down one of the alleyways that led to the huddle of shacks near the King's Mill.
Michael drew himself up to his full height. He had grown fatter during the last few months, despite his endless complaints about the paucity and poor quality of food since the plague, and his bulk and height made him a formidable size.
"I spoke at length with my lord the bishop about that," he said, referring to Thomas de Lille, the churchman who had jurisdiction over the See of Ely and the University of Cambridge within it. "He intimated my career would be better served by my remaining senior proctor."
"And how might chasing errant students in taverns in the dead of night help your career, rather than being master of a new and wealthy college?" asked Bartholomew, with raised eyebrows. He was being unfair, he knew. There was more to Michael's duties than policing the undergraduates, although keeping the rowdy, undisciplined students out of fights with the townspeople was vital to the smooth running of the town. Michael had amassed considerable power as the university's senior proctor, and recently had started to undertake duties usually performed by the Chancellor himself, much to the offended disapproval of the Vice-Chancellor, who considered such duties should have been delegated to him.
"I will be of more use to the bishop while my attentions are not divided between his interests and those of a college," said Michael, favouring Bartholomew with a superior look. "He promised to look to my advancement when the time is right."
"And you trust him?" asked Bartholomew dubiously. Bartholomew's own experiences with the bishop had taught him that although the bishop was the spiritual leader of a large part of East Anglia, he had not attained his exalted position by being pleasant, honest, and reliable. Bartholomew would not have trusted any promise made by the bishop any more than he would one made by the Chancellor.
"I do," said Michael firmly. "He needs me every bit as much as I need him. Since the death, when he lost half his monks, he has been desperately short of intelligent, able men he can trust with his business. He cannot afford to lose someone like me."
"Modestly put, brother," said Bartholomew dryly. "Has he promised to make you Chancellor one day, or is it his own position you crave?"
"Either would do nicely, Matt," said Michael comfortably.
He looked again at the clean yellow-white stone of the Lance Marie.
"This is a fine building," he said almost wistfully.
Bartholomew agreed. "I heard that the election of Thomas Bingham as its new master, after you declined the honour, was hotly contested," he said. "It all but tore the college in half." Michael's eyes glittered as he recalled the intrigues and rumours that had abounded during the race to elect Valence Marie's new master. The previous incumbent had been sent to York in disgrace after some unsavoury business involving a fraudulent relic the previous year, and his unexpected departure, as much a shock to him as to his college, had thrown the fellowship into disarray.
"I heard that considerable sums of money changed hands before Bingham finally secured the majority of votes," said Michael somewhat gleefully. "Rumour has it that James Green, his rival, is bitterly resentful."
"It will not be easy for Bingham to rule Valence Marie if it is so divided," said Bartholomew, wondering whether such a feat would be even remotely possible, given the plotting and intrigues that festered and bubbled, even when a college or hostel was in a state of relative harmony, let alone when there was a serious division among members.
"Quite," said Michael, smugly. "Another reason for declining the Chancellor's generous offer to have Valence Marie handed to me on a plate. Neither Green nor Bingham would have allowed me to run the college without fighting me at every turn, because they would have deeply resented my appointment. And on top of their ambitions, Valence Marie remains in turmoil over the bones Thorpe found last year. Some of the fellows still think that the hand he dredged from the King's Ditch was that of a saint."
Thorpe is in no position to benefit from their loyalty, said Bartholomew, thinking of how the aloof master had been transferred to a post at an obscure grammar school to punish him for his foolish belief in the bone's authenticity. The new post had been offered by the king himself, leaving Thorpe no choice but to pack up his belongings and go. They stood for a moment longer, thinking about Thorpe and his relic, and then entered Valence Marie through its handsome front gate. Bartholomew with reluctance, Michael with a growing enthusiasm, fired by the discussion of the uncertain, insalubrious world of university politics. The physician had just handed his soggy cloak and the 3 bottles of poisoned wine. He could hardly take them with him to the festivities in the hall and then the church, and there was no time to take them to Michael House first, to a curious porter, when a messenger arrived, leaning breathlessly against the door jamb. He was one of a family of tinkers who lived near the river and whose family Bartholomew had recently treated for winter fever. The tinker's sharp eyes darted everywhere, taking in the elegant tapestries that hung on the walls in the entrance hall and the highly polished brass handles on the doors. Bartholomew wondered if he was sizing it up for a future burglary. Apparently, the porter thought the same, for he bundled the tinker out of the door and demanded to know his business.
"Dr. Bartholomew," said the tinker, ignoring the porter and addressing the physician. "You are needed urgently at Master Constantine Mortimer's house. He has been struck down with pains in the stomach and asks that you attend him immediately."
"But he is not my patient," said Bartholomew. "He is in the care of Father Phileas. Do you know Phileas? He is Master of Medicine at Gonville Hall. You need to contact him, not me."
"You are far too honest," said Michael reprovingly.
"Go to Mortimer, man. He is one of the wealthiest merchants in the town, and a burgess too. He will pay you handsomely for making you miss the installation. To the devil with Phileas."
"I know Phileas," said the tinker, "but he is unwell himself, and Mistress Mortimer told me to fetch you instead. You'd better hurry, because she told me she thought he might be dying."
"It seems you are destined not to see Master Bingham take his oath of allegiance to Valence Marie, Matt," said Michael, trying to rub away the spatters of mud that clung around the hem of his fine new habit. He straightened and gave Bartholomew a wink, leaning forward to whisper conspiratorially, "You can always just come for the food later. That will be the best part anyway. I have been told there will be roast boar."
Bartholomew did not much mind the summons that took him from the tedious Latin investiture ceremony to attend a patient, grateful for the excuse to escape yet more of what was going to be a lengthy occasion. He retrieved his cloak from the porter and followed the tinker to Milne Street, where many of the wealthy town burgesses had their homes. Most of them would have been invited to the installation, and Bartholomew was sure that Master Mortimer must be ill indeed to pass up the opportunity of rubbing shoulders with some of the most influential men in the town. Activity in Milne Street was, as usual, frenetic. Raised voices yelled the prices of this and that, and goods were being carried from the barges moored at the wharves on the river to the great storerooms in the merchants' yards. Bartholomew saw wooden crates filled with clanking bottles from France, while Mortimer's own cellars were being loaded with bulging sacks of flour brought from the arable lands around Lincoln to the north. Among it all, gulls screamed and squabbled for the rubbish along the riverbanks, and a dog barked furiously at a teetering pile of cloth bales behind which a rat had fled. The rain seemed to have had little effect on trade, and bargemen and apprentices alike seemed oblivious to their dripping hoods and sodden clothes. When Bartholomew looked behind him for the tinker, he had disappeared, and the physician wondered with irritation whether one of his students was playing some kind of practical joke. Master Mortimer, the baker, was a far cry from the town's poor that Bartholomew usually treated. But, as he pondered, glancing around to see if he could detect any watching undergraduates, a woman darted out of Mortimer's house and seized his arm.
"Thank you for coming," she said. "My husband says he is dying, and Father Phileas cannot attend because he has an ague. If you had not come, we might have had to ask Robin of Grantchester."
Her horrified expression and the hush in her voice as she uttered the name bespoke the trepidation many people felt for Cambridge's only surgeon. Unlike physicians, who were university educated, surgeons were mere craftsmen. Robin of Grantchester was an insanitary individual whose habit of demanding payment before treatment to avoid the trouble of suing bereaved next of kin in the event of sudden death did little to inspire confidence in his skills. While the duties of physicians and surgeons overlapped, their techniques and expertise seldom did. Unusually for a physician, Bartholomew regularly performed a number of basic surgical operations, which led him into bitter confrontations both with his fellow physicians, who deplored the use of surgery, and with Robin, who felt his trade was being poached. Catherine Mortimer gabbled at him as she led the way through the bakery and up a wide flight of stairs to the living quarters on the upper floor. She was a pleasant woman with a kindly face and sad blue eyes, whom Bartholomew had known for years and liked. In fact, he liked her a good deal more than her husband, whose short temper and brutish behaviour made him generally unpopular with townsfolk and scholars alike. "All the apprentices are busy unloading the flour," said Catherine, "so I had to pay that tinker to act as messenger when Constantine told me he was dying and that I should summon help. I told the tinker not to go to Michael House but straight to Valence Marie, since all the fellows of the university will be there today for the celebrations. Well, not you now, I suppose."
"How long has your husband been ill?"
asked Bartholomew, as soon as he could slip a few words into her almost constant nervous babble.
"Since mid-morning," she replied, leading him along an attractive corridor with a floor of polished wood and colourful paintings on the walls.
At the end was a large, masculine room containing a massive bed surrounded by curtains of a deep red velvet and several damp, smelly dogs. The room was quiet, yet was filled with people, like that of a dying statesman. Bartholomew looked about him uneasily, uncomfortable at the notion of treating a patient in front of such a large audience. He saw the nursemaid with Mortimer's younger children gathered about her, all regarding him with frightened faces. The household priest knelt in a corner, his lips moving as he spoke soundless prayers. And a huddle of men, clearly Mortimer's foremen and chief bakers, stood near the glazed window, holding their hats awkwardly in their hands. Since no one did anything other than gaze at him expectantly, Bartholomew took the initiative and strode across the room to the curtained bed, wondering whether he had already been called too late and the baker was already dead. His footsteps clattered on the wooden floor, sounding even louder in the silent room. He drew the thick material back and peered inside. Master Constantine Mortimer lay on the bed in a tangle of covers, his face unhealthily white and his balding pate covered with a sheen of sweat. Both hands were pressed firmly to his stomach. As he heard the curtains open, he looked up and glowered, but his expression softened when he saw Bartholomew. Weakly, he flapped a hand to indicate that the physician should come closer. Bartholomew fought his way through the hangings and sat on the edge of the bed. The ailing baker looked at him helplessly, the aggressive demeanour which filled his family, his apprentices, and a good many of his colleagues with fear, absent. Bartholomew leaned over and felt his forehead. It was cold and clammy. Then he felt the life beat in Mortimer's wrist, assessing its strength and speed. It was steady, but rather faster than it should have been for a man of Mortimer's age and size, according to the guidelines established by the great Greek physician Galen. But even so, Mortimer was not dying, as everyone seemed to think.
"The messenger said you had pains," whispered Bartholomew, not liking to speak too loudly in the reverently hushed chamber.
"Terrible pains, Bartholomew," replied Mortimer hoarsely. "I am not long for this world."
He hauled up the front of his expensive linen shirt, revealing a considerable expanse of white, jelly-like flesh for Bartholomew to inspect. Bartholomew rubbed his cold hands together in a vain attempt to warm them, and then gently palpated the baker's abdomen, assuming his icy fingers, rather than discomfort, were responsible for the sharp intakes of breath on his patient's part.
"What have you eaten over the last day?" Bartholomew asked, sitting back and replacing the shirt over the vast abdomen.
"Why?"
whispered Mortimer, his face pale.
"Was it the last meal I will have on earth?"
"You are not dying, Master Mortimer. You have just eaten something that has disagreed with you. What have you had since yesterday?"
In Bartholomew's experience, patients stricken with stomach aches caused by overindulgence usually required a moment to recall precisely what they had consumed, and then they often lied about it, embarrassed to admit to their gluttony. But Mortimer answered immediately and with great precision, suggesting that food was something he took very seriously.
"Dinner last night was light, just a hare pie, venison cooked with cream, a loaf of barley bread and some egg custard to follow. I broke my fast with wine, a bowl of oatmeal, some bacon, a mess of eggs and fresh bread. Then, before I became ill, I had some fruit and a few of the cinnamon cakes my wife makes."
Bartholomew gaped at him. "Do you always eat so heartily?" Mortimer shot him a sharp look.
"I told you, dinner was light last night. I have been saving myself for the installation feast today."
Bartholomew sat back and considered. The man was clearly an habitual glutton, and so his stomach cramps were unlikely to be caused by simple greed if his constitution was used to such vast quantities of food. "Have you eaten anything different over the last day? Something you do not usually have?"
"Only the fruit," said Mortimer, "and the sugared almonds."
"Do you usually avoid fruit?"
"No," replied Mortimer. "I will eat most things."
This Bartholomew could well believe.
"But these fruits were special. Lemons from Spain."
"Lemons?" queried Bartholomew, surprised. "At this time of year? In Cambridge?" The master baker gave a superior smile.
"They are very expensive, so I would not expect a man of your meagre means to know. Thomas de Charlet, the grocer, sold some to me. I ate them quartered and dipped in fine white sugar."
Bartholomew winced at the mere concept. "You ate raw lemons?" Mortimer nodded, unaware of or indifferent to Bartholomew's revulsion.
"With sugar? I'm told they are an acquired taste and should not be given to women or children lest they disturb the humours. I bought 10. I gave one to Edward, my eldest son. I ate the rest myself."
Bartholomew shuddered, his teeth on edge. "I have been to Spain, and the people there cook lemons or use the juice for drinking with water. I have never seen anyone eat one raw, sugar or not, and certainly not 9 at once. Their juice is sour and has probably upset the balance in your stomach."
"But Thomas de Charlet said nothing of this," protested Mortimer. "He said the king has lemons at his table, and what is good enough for the king is good enough for me. I named my first son after the king, you know."
He gave Bartholomew an ingratiating smile that vanished as he was racked with a spasm of his gripes. Bartholomew poked his head through the curtains and asked Catherine to fetch warm milk from the kitchen. She glanced towards the bed, as if trying to see through the thick hangings to where her husband lay like a beached whale.
"Will he live?"
Bartholomew smiled reassuringly. "He is not dying." She regarded him uncertainly.
"Are you sure? He told me he was breathing his last."
"It is just indigestion from the lemons. It can be very painful," he added when he saw her uncertainty change to anger.
"Indigestion?" she repeated in disbelief. "He said he was on his deathbed and had me summon all these people. Now you tell me it was his greed with those wretched lemons. I told him to peel them first, but he would insist that he knew best."
With some difficulty, Bartholomew managed to interrupt her tirade and send her for the milk. When it arrived, he added a small amount of finely ground chalk powder and some laudanum. After the potion had been swallowed to the last drop, he untangled the bedclothes and made his patient comfortable for the deep sleep he knew would soon come.
"I feel better already," murmured Mortimer gratefully. "The terrible burning has eased. I will have words with de Charlet about those lemons. I wonder how the king's constitution deals with such sour foods. He must be a strong man indeed."
"I'm sure his constitution is nothing compared to yours," said Bartholomew ambiguously, helping Mortimer to ease further down the bed. Mortimer closed his eyes drowsily, but then opened them again and fixed the physician with a hard stare.
"Your reputation belies your abilities, Bartholomew. It is said you indulge in surgery, and I was expecting to be sliced open like a pig in order to be cured of my pains. But you have been as gentle with me as a mother with a newborn babe. My only complaint is that your hands are as cold as those of a corpse. Buy some gloves, man."
Bartholomew nodded vaguely and began to buckle his bag as he prepared to leave. Mortimer reached out and rested a moist, flabby hand on his wrist.
"I am quite serious, Bartholomew," the baker insisted. "You will kill someone with shock one day if you continue to place them on bare flesh in so reckless a manner. I have some gloves you can buy. Catherine!"
"No, please," began Bartholomew, but it was too late. Catherine was dispatched for the gloves, and Bartholomew's protestations that he did not want any were overridden.
"Look on them as a tool of your trade," preached Mortimer condescendingly. "A physician with cold hands is about as desirable as a baker who dribbles in his dough. Ah, here is Catherine with the gloves. Choose a pair, Bartholomew. I will make you a good deal."
"Yes, choose," said Catherine.
She smiled nervously at her husband and then addressed Bartholomew.
"But you will not pay for them. They will be a gift to compensate you for the fact that you have missed the installation in order to attend Constantine."
"What?"
gasped Mortimer in shock, attempting to raise himself from his pillow. Bartholomew opened his mouth to object, but Catherine was not interested in interruptions. It was unusual to see the shy, diffident woman cross her husband, and Bartholomew wondered whether his claim to have been brushed by death had rendered him suddenly more human and fallible in her eyes.
"Dr. Bartholomew could have declined to come to you, Constantine," she reasoned. "You are not his patient, and he will be the only fellow in the university to miss the grand installation that the town has been discussing for weeks."
"Except for Father Phileas," grunted Mortimer. "You told me he is ill too."
"And you should remember that Father Phileas would not have answered your summons until the festivities were over," said Catherine. "Now try these green gloves, Doctor. They are the best ones here, and suitably fine for a man of your profession."
"They make his hands look leprous," said Mortimer, eyeing them critically. "Give him the black pair.
Black goes with anything, and you would not want him to don green gloves with that red robe.
True enough, admitted Catherine, and the black ones are harder wearing than the green. Your sister tells me you are careless with clothes, and so you should probably take a more durable pair. Do they fit?
They fit perfectly,
announced Mortimer, as though Bartholomew was incapable of answering, leaning forward to tug at one of the fingers experimentally.
Now, if you will excuse me, I feel terribly sleepy. Next time you come to me, Bartholomew, I shall expect to be examined with hands as soft and warm as a baby's, not rough, red and frozen like a peasant's.
Bartholomew smiled and made his farewells to the baker. He ushered the assembled people and dogs out of the bedchamber, assuring them that their master needed only rest to make a full recovery, although not all of them seemed overjoyed by the news that death had been cheated of its prey. Catherine saw him to the door and handed him 2 silver pennies. It was kind of you to come when you should be at the installation.
So should you, said Bartholomew, certain that Valence Marie would not risk offending one of the most powerful merchants in the town and his wife by not issuing them an invitation. Catherine gave a long-suffering sigh.
I am tempted to go now, since it seems the reason I am to be denied is my husband's greed. But I am sure word has gone out that Constantine is gravely ill, and I do not want to appear uncaring.
When he wakes in the morning, he will be telling folk how you snatched him from the jaws of death.
My son Edward is the same. While the rest of us suffer simple rheums, he has a terrible fever. A tiny cut is a life-threatening wound with him.
Not everyone bears discomfort stoically, said Bartholomew carefully, not wanting to tell her that he considered Mortimer's summons a complete waste of his time, because the baker would have recovered perfectly well after a good night of sleep and a day of careful eating anyway. Catherine sighed again, but then became businesslike. She took Bartholomew's elegantly clad hand and smiled.
I am keeping you from the celebrations while I run on. Thank you again and enjoy the festivities.
For the third time that day, Bartholomew turned towards the hall of Valence Marie. He glanced down at his best gown and saw that it was liberally splattered with mud while water dripped from the hem. His boots were filthy, and kneeling on the rush-strewn floor of St. Bernard's Hostel to attend Armel had caused fragments of the dried plants to adhere to them. In short, he looked scruffy, impoverished, and disreputable. He wondered if the Valence Marie porter would even let him in, or whether he should obey his strong inclination to head home, perhaps to sit by the fire in the kitchen and watch the rain team past the window. He hesitated, seriously considering returning to Michael House. But, like it or not, he was committed to attending at least part of the installation ceremony, and he could not, in all conscience, use Mortimer's ailment as an excuse to stay away for much longer. He would be missed, if not by the fellows and master-elect of Valence Marie, then by his own colleagues at Michael House, some of whom would claim that his absence was a dereliction of duty and that he had done disservice to Michael House's good relations with another college. Stamping his feet to try to dislodge some of the mud from his boots, he stepped through the sturdy front gates of Valence Marie and prepared to be admonished by the condescending porter for his bedraggled appearance on such an auspicious day. The porter, however, seemed to have gone off duty, and a student was performing the role of doorman. He was considerably more polite than the porter had been, and cheerfully helped Bartholomew to brush the worst of the mud from his clothes. By the time the physician had been conducted to Valence Marie's splendid hall, the ceremony was virtually over. He stood at the back, leaning against the wall, and remembered the events of the previous summer when, had it not been for the timely intervention of Michael, he would have lost his life in that very room. Since then, the hall had been redecorated on the orders of its incoming master, and new tapestries in brightly coloured wools adorned the walls. Above his head, the wooden musician's gallery had been rebuilt and boasted some of the finest carvings in Cambridge. A group of students was there now, singing to occupy the guests, while the fellows of the Hall of Valence Marie lined up to sign the writ that would make legal the installation of Thomas Bingham as master. When the last fellow had shuffled his way forward and added his name to the official parchment, the singing stopped and Bingham began to make his speech. In Bingham's position, Bartholomew would have been brief. The election had not been unanimous, and ill feelings might be resurrected if Bingham spoke at too great a length about his victory over his rival and his plans for the college. The new master, however, had a good deal to say on a wide range of matters, and, in the body of the hall, the assembly became restless. The language of the university was Latin, and while Bartholomew and the other scholars were fluent, few of the guests from the town would understand all of Bingham's words. Despite the chilly weather, the hall filled to overflowing with people began to grow stuffy and soon became uncomfortable. Bartholomew edged nearer the door, where a welcome draught wafted in from outside, and thought about the events of the day. He wondered about the three bottles of wine still wrapped in his hat and left in the porter's lodge for safety. Had a townsperson deliberately sold the students poisoned claret? Michael clearly thought so, but Bartholomew had his doubts. He was certain the Franciscan novices would not have been behaving sufficiently rowdily to warrant someone wanting them dead. None of them had been drunk when he and Michael had arrived, and they seemed a tame group to him, particularly compared to his own students. The Franciscans seemed the kind of young men whose idea of wild behaviour was three goblets of ale and staying up past midnight, a stark contrast to some Michael House scholars whose ways of merrymaking sometimes verged on the criminal. And the business of the lemons was odd too. Bartholomew could not recall ever having seen lemons in Cambridge in February before. Mortimer must have paid dearly for such a luxury, from his purse as well as his innards. Bartholomew smiled to himself as he imagined the merchant sitting at his table, eating the sour fruits one after the other. Regardless of the amount of fine white sugar he had added, it would not have been a pleasant repast. Bartholomew recalled that Mortimer was the son of a ditcher and had worked hard to haul himself from his lowly beginnings to his present status. Whatever Mortimer had heard, Bartholomew was certain the king did not devour raw lemons on a regular basis, and it was ironic that, even as Mortimer tried to show the world he was wealthy and accomplished, he betrayed his simple origins by revealing he did not know how to prepare the luxury foods he was able to buy. At the dais to the front of the hall, Bingham looked up from his sheaf of notes and paused for breath. Immediately, someone began to clap. Bartholomew saw that it was Thomas Kenningham, the gentle master of Michael House, beaming his customary seraphic smile and nodding in a congratulatory manner to Bingham. Seizing the opportunity for an early end to the tedious speech, everyone else hastened to join in the applause, while the fellows of Valence Marie prepared to lead the procession out to the church. The students began to sing, while the people in the hall stretched stiff limbs in evident relief. Bingham's mouth dropped open in dismay, but his fellows clustered about him to offer their felicitations, and then the procession was on the move. Bingham had to scamper to take his place of honour behind them or run the risk of being left behind. Amused by Bingham's discomfiture, Bartholomew waited for the fellows from his own college as the other guests filed past him. Master Kenningham led the Michael House deputation, a guileless smile still playing about his lips, his eyes raised heavenward and his lips moving in prayer. Bartholomew had no doubt that Kenningham's timely interruption of Bingham's speech was wholly innocent. Of all the scholars in the university, the honest, kindly Gilbertine friar would be the least likely to do something purposely malicious. Behind Kenningham scurried Roger Alcott, a small, vindictive man whose ambitious eyes were already on the mastership currently occupied by Kenningham. Blind Father Paul leaned on the arm of Father William, both Franciscan friars who taught theology and the trivium, grammar, logic, and rhetoric. Michael brought up the rear with Michael House's newest felons, John Runham, who taught law, and Ralph de Langerley, who lectured in philosophy. Runham was the cousin of a previous highly unpopular master of Michael House who had died during the plague and seemed to have inherited some of his detested kinsman's less lovable traits. He was arrogant, smug, and condescending. But he was easily one of the best teachers of law Michael House had ever seen. His lectures were eloquent, precise, and logically flawless, and his reputation meant that the college was inundated with applications from students who wanted him to teach them. Because the numbers of new would-be scholars were low following the plague, a popular master like Runham was a valuable commodity, and Bartholomew tried hard to maintain a cordial relationship with him for the college's sake. Meanwhile, Runham's roommate, Ralph de Langerley, did not look at all like a philosopher. He was a hulking figure, with brawny arms so heavily muscled that they jutted from his body at an angle. As he passed, Langerley shot Bartholomew an unpleasant look for being late, which Bartholomew ignored. Although Langerley had only been a fellow for a few weeks, he had already made himself unpopular with the students and staff. He bullied the servants, belittled his undergraduates, and tried to thwart every attempt Bartholomew made to improve living conditions at Michael House. Unlike Runham, Langerley was not a good teacher. His lectures were confused and filled with contradictions, and he did not seem to enjoy them any more than did his bewildered students. He compensated for his lack of skills by making it known around the university that he was available for any other kind of work, and was making a fortune by acting as scribe and writing letters for the rich and illiterate in his ugly, laboured round hand. Bartholomew did not like Langerley, a feeling he was sure was fully reciprocated, and avoided his company whenever possible. The physician worked hard at his teaching, and his ever-growing practice of patience, and did not want to waste the little free time he had in the company of an arrogant, opinionated man like Langerley. Michael dropped behind the two new fellows so that he could walk with Bartholomew.
"I have had a complaint from the porter with whom we left that wine," he said, speaking in a low voice so that he would not be overheard. "According to him, he was moving the bottles to a safer place, although I imagine what really happened was that he was wondering whether they were worth stealing, or perhaps siphoning and diluting."
"What happened?" asked Bartholomew anxiously. "I hope to God he did not drink any."
"Fortunately for him, no," said Michael. "But he touched the bottle, as you specifically instructed him not to do. He has a burn on his hand the size of an egg."
He shuddered.
"Lord help us, Matt. What is that stuff?"
Chapter 2. Bartholomew told Michael about Mortimer's lemons as they walked to St. Botolph's Church, where prayers would be offered for the new master and his college. As if to compensate for the long ceremony at Valence Marie, the college priests rattled through the mass at a speed that left the congregation bewildered, after which everyone trooped back to Valence Marie for the feast. Evidently, the servants had anticipated more time to prepare, for the hall was in disarray, and students had to be commandeered into helping set up trestle tables and lay out trenches, while the guests milled about in the courtyard in growing ill humour. By the time the steward announced that the feast would begin, most people were cold, wet, and irritable. The feast itself, however, was impressive, and Bartholomew imagined that Mortimer would be sorely disappointed to learn what he had missed. As Michael had predicted, the highlight of the meal was roast boar, each animal carried on a huge platter by two servants. Bartholomew used to simple Michael House fare et sparingly, and did not need the example of Mortimer to warn him of the dangers of overindulgence. Next to him, Michael ate as though it were his last meal on earth, while on his other side, Langley provided impressive competition. Wine flowed freely, and as the feast progressed, the hall became hot, noisy, and stuffy. The final course, produced with a flourish by Valence Marie's steward, was lemons stewed with cinnamon and black pepper, which once again reminded Bartholomew of Mortimer. Thomas de Chalet, the grocer, must have made a good deal of money from his shipment of lemons, Bartholomew thought, declining the dish as it was offered. Michael helped himself to a generous portion, but left most of it, puckering his lips and screwing his eyes tightly closed at the sourness. As the daylight faded, braziers around the wall were lit, making the room hotter than ever. Michael House possessed no such braziers, and Bartholomew was envious, for the light was ample by which to read, and even one such lamp would have eased the boredom of long winter nights when darkness came early. Valence Marie possessed fine silver too, and huge jewelled chalices were placed at regular intervals along the tables, filled with almonds and raisins. Expensive commodities that were just one indication of the feast's extravagance. When the meal was over, and the tables vaguely cleared of spilled grease, animal bones, and bread trenchers, Master Bingham rose to his feet, an intimidating sheaf of parchments clutched in his hands. He cleared his throat importantly and looked haughtily around the hall at the assembled guests who were about to be treated to that part of his painstakingly prepared discourse he had been deprived of giving earlier. Michael groaned loudly, and Bartholomew felt his heart sink. But Bingham had done no more than make a preparatory rap for silence on the table with his spoon before the student minstrels in the gallery increased the volume of their singing dramatically, and the fellows on either side of their new master reached up to pull him back into his seat. Thorpe, the previous master of Valence Marie, would never have countenanced such an affront to his authority, thought Bartholomew, amused by Bingham's ineffectual outrage at his colleague's presumption.
"Bingham will have a hard task controlling this new college of his,"
yelled Michael, putting his sweaty face near Bartholomew's to make himself heard over the racket. Bartholomew nodded vigorously.
"I wonder what those two are plotting."
Michael pointed to where the sheriff and the mayor sat, their heads bent together confidentially as they conversed in what seemed to be furtive whispers. Bartholomew liked Sheriff Tulliot, a small, wiry man with a wispy, fair beard and a tolerance towards the university usually absent in town officials. Tulliot saw them looking at him and raised a hand in affable acknowledgement. Even from a distance, the sheriff looked tired and strained, and there were rings of exhaustion under his pale blue eyes. Tulliot's position was not an easy one to hold. His garrison had been sadly depleted by the plague, and it was difficult to recruit replacements when crime was by far more lucrative. Since Christmas, a band of outlaws had settled in the area, using little-known causeways and canals in the fens to make their escape after robbing travellers on the roads, disappearing as completely and cleanly as the marsh mists in sunlight long before Tulliot's men could catch them. Bartholomew smiled a greeting to him and looked around the hall. Sheriff Tulliot and the mayor were not the only ones to be taking advantage of the installation festivities to conduct a little business. Bartholomew's brother-in-law, Sir Oswald Stanmore, was engaged in an animated discussion with the master of Gomville Hall, while Bartholomew's sister was abandoned to entertain the morose Prior of Barmwell on her other side. The university was one of the Stanmore's biggest customers, and he was clearly embarking on some deal or other with the master of one of its most powerful colleges. At the high table at the far end of the hall, Vice-Chancellor Harling, the university's second-in-command, sat between the Countess of Pembroke and a handsome woman in her middle years who Michael had identified as the abbess of nearby Denby Abbey, a rich community of Franciscan nuns. Harling's jet-black hair glistened greasily in the candlelight as he inclined his head politely towards the Countess, giving every appearance of listening with rapt attention to what she was saying.
"Why is Harling in the seat of honour?"
asked Bartholomew of Runham, who sat opposite him, speaking loudly to make himself heard over the discordant singing from the gallery and the roar of drunken voices.
"Where is the Chancellor?"
Runham pursed his lips to indicate his disapproval.
"With the Bishop in Ely. It is a mere 17 miles, so I do not know why Chancellor Tinkle could not have made the effort to be here. An installation is, after all, an important university occasion."
"Perhaps his business at Ely is more urgent than gossiping with the Countess of Pembroke and the Abbess of Denny," said Bartholomew. A servant slapped a dish of sugared almonds so hard in front of him that some of them bounced across the table to be claimed by Michael. When Bartholomew glanced up at him, the man gave a cheerful wink, and his red cheeks suggested that the guests were not the only ones to have availed themselves of Valence Marie's endless supplies of wine.
"Tinkle is probably too afraid to come back," said Runham uncharitably. "He knows he is not up to the task of being Chancellor, and is hiding away in Ely behind the Bishop's skirts."
The post of Chancellor was not a position Bartholomew would have willingly held. While it granted the holder a degree of authority over the university and the town, it was also fraught with political pitfalls. The previous incumbent had held office for 4 years, but the constant intrigues and crafty plotting had finally worn him down, and he had retreated to his family home in the Fens in poor health. Harling, his vice-chancellor, had expected to step into his shoes, as was the usual practice. But in an election that had astonished many scholars almost as much as Harling, a timid nonentity called William Tinkle, who had only agreed to stand for election because he thought it might raise the profile of his hostel in the university community, had won the majority of votes. Bartholomew might have questioned the honesty of the vote counters, had it not been for the expression of abject horror on Tinkle's face when he was declared the winner. Harling had accepted his defeat with dignity and had volunteered to continue as vice-chancellor, an offer that Tinkle had accepted gratefully, openly acknowledging his inexperience in the treacherous world of university politics.
"Tinkle!" muttered Runham in disgust. "What a dreadful choice to be the leader of our university. All I can say is that I did not vote for him."
He gazed speculatively at Bartholomew.
"Neither did I," said Bartholomew, not wanting to be blamed for the Chancellor's absence.
Runham nodded, satisfied, and went on.
"I am not a man to risk my good health by bathing, but I am always careful to scent my clothes with lavender and leave my clean linen on the shelf in the latrine to kill the lice. But Tinkle does neither. There is an odour about him I find most unpleasant."
"I always feel itchy after an audience with him,"
boomed Father William, whose Franciscan habit was one of the filthiest garments in Christendom, and who paid scant attention to his own personal cleanliness. To prove his point, he began to scratch, and Bartholomew was amused to see Runham and then Michael follow suit. A few moments later, Alcott started, and then Master Kenningham. It continued until Kenningham, somewhat out of the blue, changed the subject by asking if anyone had ever debated the question, "Let us consider whether the edge of the universe can be touched." And as the discussion grew more heated, the itches were forgotten. Listening to his colleagues with half an ear, Bartholomew watched Harling and the Countess, who, judging from the flapping of her hands, seemed to be telling him how to fly. The Vice-Chancellor reached out a beringed hand, took up his wine goblet, and drained it without taking his eyes off the Countess's face. Immediately, a servant hurried to refill it, and a few moments later, the entire process was repeated. Bartholomew had heard that, despite her generosity and resulting popularity, the Countess was not a lady renowned for conversational sparkle. He suspected Harling knew he had a long night ahead of him and was preparing himself by dulling his mind with as much of Valence Marie's wine as he could stow away without losing consciousness. Perhaps Chancellor Tinkle had been wiser than all of them with his timely absence from the town. Harling was given a brief respite from the Countess's monologue as Sheriff Tulliot stepped forward to make his excuses for leaving early to the august occupants at the high table. Under his cloak, he always wore a mail tunic and boiled leather leggings in anticipation of a nocturnal foray in search of the elusive outlaws.
"Poor Harling," said Michael, watching as the Countess homed in on the Vice-Chancellor again as Tulliot left. "I am reliably informed that the noble Marie de Valence is about as interesting a companion as stagnant ditch water."
"At least stagnant ditch water does not hog the conversation," bawled Runham, who had won the debate about the edge of the universe simply because he had a good deal more to say about it than anyone else.
He leaned towards the monk, the flowing sleeve of his fine ceremonial gown knocking over Bartholomew's wine, and lowered his voice a fraction.
"She has but two interests, breeding dogs and gardening."
"She is a very generous woman," Bartholomew pointed out. "She founded this college and the abbey at Denny, and she gives alms to the poor."
"But gardening, Matt," said Michael in distaste, "that is for peasants."
"Edward II liked gardening, and look what happened to him," said Runham ominously.
"I hardly think King Edward was executed because of his love of horticulture," said Bartholomew dryly. "I imagine his murder had more to do with the fact that he was an abysmal ruler."
"Please," whispered Michael, glancing around him furtively. "Edward II founded King's Hall, and their warden is looking right at us. If we are to indulge ourselves in treasonous talk, at least wait until I am too drunk to care."
"Gardening is a vile pastime," continued Runham, undeterred. "All that dirt and dreadful creatures like worms and slugs creeping about. Try some of this candied mint, Matthew. It is quite delicious."
"People who eat that sort of thing die young," said Michael, knowledgeably, eyeing the dish of sticky leaves disdainfully. "It is a well-known medical fact."
"I see," said Bartholomew, laughing. "And is this well-known medical fact from the same source as green vegetables cause leprosy and a diet of nothing but meat and bread prevents baldness that you mentioned to me last week?" Michael favoured him with a withering look.
"You read too much, Matt. You refuse to believe anything unless it has been written by one of your dull Greek or Arab physicians. The facts to which I refer stem from simple common sense. Look at Harling. There is a man who declines his vegetables, and he has a magnificent thick black mane.
The fact that cunning cooks have slipped the occasional bit of cabbage or carrot into my meals accounts entirely for my thinning hair.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.